So thanks very much for your attention, and look forward to any questions.
Thanks, Lyndon. I thought that was a really great presentation. I was especially struck by the 73 billion a year figure that we were spending on preparing for a nuclear war. We now have Sjoerd. Could you please, I don't know if you wanted a PowerPoint, but you have the floor.
Thanks. I hope you can see my screen now.
Yes, we can.
And thanks very much for having me. It's a really great pleasure to be back at the BISA Global Nuclear Order Working Group this year, especially in this panel with my good friends, Lyndon and Benoit. And thanks very much for organizing to the conveners and organizers. Thanks very much. I think my presentation today follows on really quite well from what Lyndon just talked about. I guess you could say that I'm talking about one piece of what Lyndon calls the Nuclear Hotel California, namely that last slide he had on alliance politics. And my presentation today is for a paper on extended nuclear deterrence, reassessing the credibility of extended nuclear deterrence. And I can only apologize to those of you who may have heard me give this presentation a couple of days ago virtually in Glasgow. So let me start my presentation and talk about the theoretical premise, or rather the theoretical premise assumption that I'm trying to critique or undermine in my paper, which is the following one. It's formulated in many different ways, but I would argue this is a dominant view in sort of mainstream security studies. Here is the formulation by famous English historian Michael Howard, who argued that Allied leaders craved American promises of nuclear protection, not just in the negative role of a deterrent to Soviet aggression, but in the positive role of a reassurance to the West Europeans, the kind of reassurance a child needs from its parents or an invalid from his doctors against dangers which, however remote, cannot be entirely discounted. I'm gonna, for the purposes of this presentation, jump over the somewhat problematic language words used in this exact quote. The point I'm making here is that this view is quite mainstream in security studies. This exact sentence is cited dozens of times in academic publications in a positive way, as a premise and an assumption for any analysis of extended nuclear deterrence. Another formulation of essentially the same theoretical premise is often referred to as the Healy theorem. And it goes like this. Dennis Healy, the former defense minister of the UK, said it takes only 5% credibility of American retaliation to deter the Russians, but 95% credibility to reassure the Europeans. So what are we talking about here? Well, I would say that in a nutshell, the theoretical premise here in security studies is that non-nuclear allies are highly paranoid and needy, and they worry quite obsessively about the credibility of their patrons' extended nuclear deterrence guarantees. And in the absence of credible assurances from their patron, clients are expected to pursue independent nuclear weapon programs and or to demand credibility building measures such as hardware deployments on their soil by their patron. And so we have very often here a loop where the absence of these things, demands for increased reassurance, is taken as evidence that the extended nuclear deterrent guarantee is credible, or in the language of the Healy theorem, that it's even more than 95% credible. So in my paper, I look at this in more detail historically in the context of Norway-US relations. So Norway obviously is a member of NATO, is a founding member back from 1949. And I would argue that Norway, if we assume this theory, this theoretical premise to be true, then it certainly should apply to Norway. After all, Norway is a country on the periphery of NATO. It shares a border with Russia, traditionally the adversary of Norway specifically and NATO generally. Norway also has lootable resources. It has a fairly thinly populated territory, which back in the late 50s and early 60s was used as an argument in favor of using potentially using tactical nuclear weapons to knock back a possible Russian invasion of the region bordering Russia. And Norway also has a high technological and economic capacity, meaning Norway could produce nuclear weapons if it wanted to. So, as you have already guessed, I'm trying to test this assumption in the Norway-US case. So the research questions that I'm asking, this is, I suppose, the same question, but formulated in a couple of different ways. So how do extended nuclear deterrence arrangements, or often called nuclear umbrellas, endure in the face of these seemingly very difficult credibility problems? As we remember from the Healey theorem, we are supposed to be at the 95 confidence level and upwards in order to avoid what we would expect to see if the credibility of the guarantee eroded. An alternative formulation is quite simply, well, the Healey theorem is correct. Are non-nuclear allies obsessively worried about the credibility of extended nuclear deterrence? Is this really the case empirically? And before I move on, I would just say that what I'm talking about here are, of course, sort of formalized nuclear umbrellas. That's what I'm talking about. Not necessarily general alignment with a nuclear armed state, but what is referred to as nuclear umbrella. So for example, if you look at US allies, countries like Thailand and the Philippines are rarely included in the list of umbrella countries, even though they have alliances with the United States. Anyway, I'm talking about nuclear umbrellas and the their credibility. So just before we move on again, I'm not asking about the effectiveness of extended nuclear deterrence vis-a-vis third parties, or in this case, Russia. What I'm talking about and interested in for the purposes of this paper is the relationship between the United States and Norway, and how Norwegian and American foreign policy and security elites assess the credibility of the nuclear umbrella over Norway. So my argument is, again, as you've probably guessed, that extended nuclear deterrent arrangements can and do endure even in the absence of credibility. I'm arguing that since essentially the 1950s, influential foreign policy and defense elites on both sides of the Atlantic, both in Washington and in Oslo, have essentially been very skeptical about the credibility of the US pledge to use nuclear weapons in defense of Norway. So this is, again, slightly different to the question of whether a conflict involving Norway might escalate to a nuclear level. You know, it could escalate to a level where American national interests were fully triggered and the United States wanted to use nuclear weapons sort of on its own behalf. That's a slightly different issue, in my opinion anyway, that is related to the general alignment of a non-nuclear and a nuclear armed state, and not to these specific or articulated nuclear umbrella arrangements. So we don't have time to go into all the details, all the empirics about what different leaders have said at different times. Suffice it to say that in public, of course, both Norwegian and American policymakers have in public expressed what you would expect people in what Lyndon calls the nuclear hotel California to say. They say it's credible. But on the back room, in private, in memos, after retirement, they say something completely different. And it's quite clear also when doing anonymous interviews with these elites that the extended nuclear deterrent arrangement is essentially like Santa Claus. It's something everyone pretends to believe in, but which everyone sort of agrees doesn't actually exist. However, despite the fact that Norwegian policymakers have not seen the US nuclear umbrella as credible, they don't believe that the Americans will fight nuclear war on Norway's behalf. But nevertheless, they have eschewed both an independent nuclear weapon program, and they've rejected credibility building measures such as US deployments of troops and or nuclear weapons, which is what mainstream security studies would have you believe would be the natural consequences of a loss of credibility of a nuclear umbrella. This has been different, of course, for different members of the NATO alliance. If you look at Germany, for example, where pretty much the same thing happened, where you had in the 1950s a realization that the Soviet Union's development of nuclear weapons meant that the umbrella was no longer credible. You had the foreign deployment by the United States of thousands of nuclear weapons deployed, many of them usable, so-called tactical weapons, deployed close to the border with the Warsaw Pact. And if you follow Paul Bracken's work on command and control, the entire point of this was to create a regional doomsday machine that circumvented US presidential sole authority and by extension, the entire credibility problem, because you would then no longer rely on an American president positively authorizing the use of nuclear weapons on behalf of an ally in another hemisphere. You would instead just have built a situation where escalation to the nuclear level would be very, very difficult to stop in the first place. But Norway fully realized this, but opted for a completely different strategy to and try to limit tensions and avoid being targeted altogether. So a Norwegian policymaker sort of tacitly recognized, acknowledged that they were under the nuclear umbrella only in name and not really in practice. However, in public, of course, they went along with everything and have as Lyndon says, said everything, at least in public, that you would expect people in the nuclear hotel California to say. So then the second part of my paper is to ask the question of why, if this is a charade, why maintain it? Why continue to uphold these tropes? I believe there are several interests involved here, several of these incentives that Lyndon talked about. And many of them are specific to either the United States or to Norway, but there's one, I think, important one that is shared by both American and Norwegian elites, which is the idea that negating or even publicly questioning the credibility of the nuclear umbrella would eliminate what little or marginal, minimal credibility there was, and thus negate any potential deterrent effect. So if we take the language of the Healey theorem again, it may be that these policymakers think there's not a 95% credibility, but perhaps a 1% credibility, but they would quite like to have that 1% rather than to have nothing. And then let's move on to the American, specifically American interests. I believe there are at least three, and I've sketched them down here. So firstly, I think there is a strong interest in trying to share the moral burden of nuclear defense to counteract emergent norms against nuclear arms. So it's a good thing for the Americans and for the American nuclear complex to be able to say that the nuclear program is being perpetuated not just for the narrow interests of America, but in order to protect allies and that to sort of avoid being isolated as norm defiers. Then a second incentive or interest here is that openly acknowledging that one umbrella arrangement lacks credibility. So for example, the US-Norway umbrella, that might undermine the credibility of other umbrella arrangements, which are believed to have more value. For example, the US-South Korean nuclear umbrella, where perhaps the Americans think that the South Koreans really do believe that the umbrella has value in and of itself. Lastly, I think nuclear weapons play an important role as a sort of symbol of power and prestige in alliances, and that they can be used as instruments in intra-alliance politics for sort of hegemonic or leadership, if you will, ambitions. Then the final point is about the Norwegian interests. And I've identified four of them. I think, firstly, loyalty, going along with the Nuclear Hotel California, is seen as a prerequisite for conventional military assistance. Of course, what Norwegian policymakers fear is that if they speak out against the nuclear aspect of the alliance, if they withdraw from the nuclear umbrella, then the Americans will simply cancel NATO, or at least NATO in relation to Norway. And that, which is something Lyndon could also talk about, I'm sure, which is a similar thing to what happened with New Zealand in the mid 1980s, where the United States essentially pulled out unilaterally of the ANZUS alliance in retaliation to the New Zealand anti-nuclear laws. Then secondly, a second Norwegian interest or incentive to go along with the status quo is that being a good ally is believed to afford access to meetings with American Secretary of State or Defense or the Undersecretary or whatever. It's seen as a ticket to political access. Then thirdly, I think loyalty is also seen to be a prerequisite for institutional and interpersonal status seeking in the transatlantic security community. And this dovetails quite well, I think, with what Lyndon said earlier, that all of the incentive structures work to solidify the status quo. After all, American policymakers and to a large extent scholars are also have significant authority within this transatlantic security community, and they are to a certain extent they control who gets to climb in the status hierarchy and these kinds of things. And then finally, I think there's been a fear in Norway over the years that disloyalty or speaking out against the nuclear umbrella or against the American nuclear strategy is fair to have a material cost. For example, in the 1950s, there was a military assistance program in place, which if had it been cancelled by the Americans, would probably have led to a doubling or tripling of the Norwegian defense budget overnight, as there was lots of cheap and even free military hardware that came with that military assistance program. So I think all of these interests on the Norwegian side incentivize trying to be loyal and ingratiate oneself to the Americans and go along with what they say. So yeah, that's what I had planned to say today. And if you have any comments or pushbacks, I would be very interested to hear them. Thanks very much.
Thanks, Chof. So Santa Claus doesn't exist.
Sorry, no, I meant the Easter Bunny. Santa Claus does exist.
How can you say that with Christmas coming up? Okay. Thank you very much. Great presentation. Benoit.
Hello, good afternoon, everyone. So I'm Benoit Pelopidas. I created the Nuclear Knowledges Program at Sciences Po in Paris. So I feel among friends and family here. A long time ago, I was much more directly involved with the PISA Global Nuclear Order Working Group. And my presentation this year will be very different from anything I've ever presented today. It's essentially a call for advice that you could also call for help. very specific one. It's because I have just published in French a really, really large paper on popular culture in nuclear politics. And when I say really, really large, I mean 25,000 words. So essentially the question I have is, I will tell you what I think the contributions of the paper are and what the empirics are. So I'm curious about, from your standpoint, which bits of it would be most important or most relevant as I proceed towards writing an English version of it? Because arguably I'll have to either make choices or expand and go all the way to book format. So this is where your help is gonna be super helpful. So the starting point of this is a fundamental challenge, which is the disbelief that we, all citizens living in a nuclear armed world, have in the possibility of nuclear disaster. This was originally articulated by German philosopher Gunther Anders as the Promethean discrepancy, and maybe most recently by Pulitzer Prize winning author Richard Rhodes, when he said, wrote in 2014, you know, no one in the corridors of power believes that the damn things can go off. So a fundamental disbelief in the possibility of unwanted nuclear catastrophe. And I mean, one empirical contribution of this paper is that I interviewed policymakers, both supporters of the term nuclear deterrence and opponents of nuclear deterrence, activists, artists, and all of them kind of shared candidly how challenging, how difficult it is to believe what we know, which is to believe that it remains possible that nuclear war happens. So in the face of that, I'm essentially making a series of conceptual, aesthetic, and historical arguments that I'm gonna just briefly lay out for you. The conceptual ones simply have to do with the fact that imagination, and in that respect, imagining the possibility of nuclear war, should be treated as constitutive of political agency. More specifically, the second argument is that a crucial role should be given to fiction, and in particular to popular visual culture, in overcoming our disbelief in the possibility of nuclear disaster. So fiction would be a tool to make us believe what we know. And if this is correct, then the third argument is that there is one underexplored effect of the so-called nuclear revolution, which is to elevate the role of fiction as an irreplaceable source of political awareness in a world of nuclear vulnerability. So those are the three conceptual arguments. Now, on the aesthetic front, there are three arguments also. First, I'm articulating, and I will tell you what those gestures are. I'm articulating four aesthetic gestures which allow the viewer an experience of the possibility of nuclear war. And we essentially document through survey that this experience has an effect on the viewer. I'll tell you what the four aesthetic gestures are, but just identifying them is a first argument. Then the second argument is that there is a trope, frequent trope, that mostly scholars of gender studies will be familiar with, the trope of the warrior-hero-protector. It suffices to ensure that the representation of the possibility of nuclear war will fail. And surprisingly, I find this failure in movies that are very, very different from each other, which both challenge the expectations of the viewer in several ways, Le Chant du Loup in France in 2019 and the Mission Impossible franchise in the US. And every single time both of those touch upon the possibility of nuclear war, this possibility kind of gets derailed by the fact that it's literally incompatible with the trope of the warrior, hero, protector that would just become a barbaric, revengeful individual. The third aesthetic argument, and that's the one I'm most interested in, is that in archival kind of documentation about Reagan, in the survey, in interviews with Ambassador Alexander Kmynt, there we found evidence that, I mean, of course, more needs to be done, but we found evidence that in order for fiction to have an impact, it's much more likely if it denies cathartic relief at the end of the spectacle. What I mean by that is threats in the day after deny cathartic relief. They leave you in an agonizing situation in which it's much easier, it's much harder to close the door between the experience of the viewing and your normal life. Movies that are arguably better movies by much more famous directors, such as Dr. Strangelove or War Games, allow you cathartic relief, either through the spectacle of the end of the world, the end of Strangelove, or by the spectacle that you know you've avoided it. And there is this catharsis of global reconciliation in the name of our common survival. But in the survey, as well as for Reagan and for Ambassador Kmynt, turns out that the movies that actually had an impact are not Strangelove, they're not the fancy ones, they're the ones that leave you in agony, threads, and the day after. Then there are two historical arguments that I'm trying to make with this paper. One is simply a history of political culture, because it's an empirically heavy paper, which surveys as much as I could see and review of the representation of nuclear weapons in popular culture visually from 1950 to 2019. And in it, there is an interesting divide, clear divide between all the decades pre-1990 and all the decades post-1990. In all the decades pre-1990, the four gestures that I identified that allow us to experience the possibility of nuclear war, they are frequently displayed. After 1990, they are not displayed at all, with two exceptions. Their referent object shifts from nuclear war to climate-related or environmental disasters, pandemics, or asteroids threatening to hit the Earth. So this kind of divide between the entire pre-1990 culture and the post-1990 culture that I can specify if you're interested in is the first historical argument. The second historical argument is just an imaginal or a cultural underpinning of an argument that Scholz has made in his international affairs article on, you know, the idea that the 1990s has been mischaracterized as the golden age of nuclear disarmament, but instead that it was an age of perpetualization of nuclear weapons. So this is just adding a layer, a cultural layer that made this possible because we essentially lost the experience of the possibility of nuclear war. So those are the two historical arguments that I wanted to make. If you want to ask me to expand, those are the two ways in which I could expand. And so I'm curious also about whether you think that those are worthwhile avenues. The first one is that at Reese's workshop, I've discovered that there is a BBC TV show called Vigil, which I wasn't aware of, because it was made in 2021. So I'd be interested in extending the Mission Impossible, Le Chant du Loup analysis, which shows similar tropes of the hero, warrior, protector, and see whether they extend to Vigil as well, regardless of so-called national strategic culture. And one additional thing that I could explore is essentially the how awareness of the possibility of nuclear disaster manifests itself. There is a really interesting paper in Social Problems published in 2020 by Bergstrand and Robertson, which is based on interviews of people who experienced the 2018 Hawaii missile scare. And what this paper shows is that what distinguishes those who get engaged from those who don't, engaged meaning engaged in nuclear weapons politics, as opposed to those who don't, is whether they experience not fear, as we would have expected, but sadness. And so that's something that I could also kind of expand upon. So as I said, I mean, it's also an empirically very rich paper, which has a series of interviews, two surveys, and an analysis of global popular culture of the last 70 years. So there is a case to be made also, if you think so, that just focusing on the empirics would be a good way to go. So if I have two more minutes, I can tell you what the four aesthetic gestures are, and otherwise I can stop here.
No, you have 2 minutes.
Excellent. Okay. So those four gestures are, the first one is the obvious one, is showing the beginning of nuclear war, right? We've seen Dr. Strangelove, we see the beginning of nuclear war, we've seen Failsafe, we see the beginning of the nuclear war, we've seen The Day After, we've seen Akira. All of this shows the beginning of nuclear war. But this is not by far the only aesthetic gesture you can make to make this experience livable. The second one is that you create the sense that nuclear war is possible because it happens and the narration of it happens before it is forgotten, but we do not get to see its beginning. And in that respect, Malville, which is originally a novel, but then a movie by Christian de Challonge in 1981, is an example in which you don't see the beginning of nuclear war. People are underground in a basement, and what you hear is a big shock. And then the question is, do they go out, and what happens to those who go out? The only thing you see is that the light goes off. Threads is also an example of that. We don't see the beginning. The third gesture is making the possibility of nuclear war as inevitability through what Angèle Hibert has called l'attente apocalyptique. So I can't translate that into English, but it's essentially shifting the value of time by essentially conveying the message to the viewer that nuclear war has started, it's coming, and the experience of viewing is just waiting until the moment when it hits you, but you know it will. There's no puzzle about whether it will or will not hit you. And so the obvious example of that is on the beach, but more recently, Offret or Le Sacrifice by Andrei Tarkovsky, or even Miracle Mile in 1989. So third gesture. Fourth gesture being problematizing complacency vis-a-vis the possibility of nuclear war. My obvious favorite in that genre is Akira Kurosawa's I Live in Fear, which essentially is problematizing what's being crazy. Is it being fearless in the face of nuclear vulnerability? Or is it being terrified to the point that you want to move your family to Brazil because you think they will be safe there? Another example of that genre would be Hiroshima Mon Amour, d'Alain René, when they essentially show the lovemaking as an experience of essentially encountering ash. And what's interesting, I think, with those four gestures is that, contrary to what one could be afraid of, they don't all require to display an insane amount of nuclear violence. Only the first one does. I could essentially expand on those gestures. The final comment I'll make on the aesthetic gestures is that in the post-1990 world, I've even seen signs that the genre is playing with the knowledge that, of course, the viewer knows that this won't happen. So it explicitly plays with the fact that we all know it's theater and we're just trying to scare each other just for fun. There is a Jack Black show from 2014 directed by Jay Roach that plays exactly on that trope. So those are the avenues I could pursue. Tell me if any of that is interesting. If none of it is, then I'll go on holiday. Thank you.
Thanks, Benoit. Don't go on holiday. Have a break, but don't. I'm going to abuse my position because I just can't help it, because the three presentations were absolutely fantastic. I'm going to try and be as quick as possible about it. If I can't get all my comments and questions in, I'm going to email you all, but I thought you all did a brilliant job. So if I'll start with Lyndon. I think sort of what I was really taken with is, I guess, two questions. Firstly, is the Hotel California device that you use, a lot of your examples are US centric, right? And so I guess what I would like to see is you to push outside of the US examples, as many as there are, and of course there's so many, but I'd kind of like to see it outside of the US context, right? I think it would help to make, I believe you, Pace, right? I think it's very convincing, but I want to be convinced even more beyond the US case. So if you can do that, that I think would make the case even stronger. And then my second question is sort of a more important question, really, which is, what is it going to take? Because, you know, it seems to me, you know, how many bed bugs are you going to get into the hotel to get the residents out, right? Because you do a great job at sort of showing, why these people stay in the hotel and the incentives are so high and everything. But how do you get to reverse that security claim? I think Benoit gives a little bit of an answer in his talk, right, through the use of fiction and popular culture. But I guess I'd like to sort of see your reaction to that, Lyndon. I don't know much about the Norwegian case, so I can't speak to that. My limited knowledge is obviously around the Asian cases, and I'm still getting past the whole standard doesn't exist. But I guess I've got three broad questions. The first is, I was really taken with your moral burden point. And although you didn't say it, so I'm putting words in your mouth and you can tell me to take them out if I'm wrong. The United States is the only country that has used nuclear weapons in war. No other country can quite make that claim. There are countries that have tested these weapons and caused huge damage and even loss of life, right? So there are testers and there are actual countries that have used these weapons, i.e. the United States, in war. Again, this is a bit similar to my first question for Lyndon. Is this a particular US problem, right? So if China is offering a nuclear umbrella, it's not, but let's say if it's offering a nuclear umbrella or Russia is offering a nuclear umbrella, do they not have the same level of moral burden? That's where I'm going. The second question is, I think it's a bit unfair, my question, but I know you say you're not interested in third parties here, but they're somewhat interlinked, right? I mean, umbrellas are also a force projection. They're a projector, right? I mean, it's not simply the case that they exist in a bilateral vacuum, right? You know, so look at the case of US-Japan. It's clearly that the US-Japan nuclear umbrella is not just about reassuring Japan, it's also about deterring, of course, North Korea, it's about deterring China, and it's about having the ability to have capabilities, not just nuclear, right, as part of that. Nuclear umbrellas usually coexist alongside many other military and defense arrangements. They don't exist on their own, right? They might even be a very small part of a broader arrangement. So sort of disaggregating them is quite hard. I think a question for both you and for Lyndon, and maybe even for Benoit, is a question about time. So I was thinking constantly throughout all your presentations, doesn't time matter? I mean, the longer something carries on, the longer we have the status quo, the longer you don't do something, the harder it gets to change, right? I mean, at least this is what I'm thinking right now, that you get stuck in a rut, right? And so this question of time, how do you combat time, right? That was nagging me at the back of my head when I was listening to all three questions. And Benoit, I'll be very quick. I see your paper in two parts, the way you presented it, but I'd have to read it. I really see the fiction and the last section that you talked about as one, and then the middle bit around sort of, you know, these other political and historical, I see that somewhat separate, but I'd have to read it to make that claim. But it felt like that I was listening to it. And I loved this idea, and your background works very well for it, about this relationship between the fiction and popular culture, have it being a tool, right? But I probably have to read it. My French isn't good enough to read it in French, but how do you actually get that out there? Like, if you believe what Lyndon says, that, you know, the money is out there if you're, you know, is supportive of the deterrence, but if you're not, you know, you're not going to get money. How are you going to get published? How are you going to get on the headlines of Time magazine? How are you going to do all that stuff in terms of, you know, fiction and popular culture when, if you, you know, as Lyndon says, in a material sense, the world is out there to get you. It doesn't help you. It doesn't enable you in that context, right? How are you going to get the publishers and so forth and the access? And then similarly, how are you going to get people to experience it? I mean, I've often found myself, if I hear of something that's happening, oh, you can experience a virtual refugee camp, or you can experience all these, there is part of me that almost doesn't want to do it, right? I mean, it's, you know, I wouldn't call it a fear. It's just, it's such an ugly experience, right? And you want to protect yourself from it, right? So how do you get over that? I'm still not sure, like I've heard how you would, right? And I think it would be very useful even for myself. Okay, last thing, Benoit, is I kept thinking about, you know, fear is totally the wrong emotion when we're talking about nuclear weapons, you know. Sadness, like you said, maybe. A sense of self, of protecting yourself, right? It's not fear, it's different, right? Protecting yourself is somewhat different from fear. And when we're talking about fear, what type of fear? Is it a fear of death, a type of death? You know, I kept thinking that when you were talking about fiction and movies and horror movies, I mean, they play on this fear of death, right? Which we always sort of put at the back of our minds, that's how we live, right? We don't think about death every day. If we did, unless you're a philosopher of that particular area, it would be very hard to live like that all the time. So it kept thinking about, you know, if we think about fear, what type of fear? Is it really fear of death? And if it's not, and if fear is the wrong emotion, then what is the best emotion? Is it sadness, perhaps? Okay, last comment, because I know I've dominated already, but I hate the term that's very popular. It's been popular since the 80s, you know, nuclear war can never be won, must never be fought. It seems to me hugely problematic in the context of the three presentations you've all just made, in the sense that, in a way, there is a, you know, in a way, it's saying that it's underpinning the very problem that you will say, that there is a belief that war can actually be fought. That's why we have to say this, right? That's why we have to promote this slogan. Or maybe I misread it, but that's how I've always read it, that it actually reinforces this view that there is a belief, and that's why we have to keep saying it, to say it, make ourselves feel differently. Okay, I'm going to shut up now. I'm very happy for you to all to come back with me now if you have immediate reactions, or I can immediately go to the floor. So it's up to you if you want to come back to me on any of those things. Yes, Benoit, you're unmuted, but I can't hear you.
Okay. Yeah.
Oh, yes, I can.
I just thought we were going to go in the order of the presentations. So I expect.
Yes, we can, definitely. Lyndon, if you want to react to that. I know I threw out a lot.
You did. Thank you,
sorry.
Nicola. Really fantastic.
That you don't want to answer them.
No, all good. There's a lot there, so I'll try and go quickly. So Reagan, Gorbachev, it was not true then, and it's not true now. The military establishment hated Reagan saying it. They did everything they could to try and stop him saying it. And he said it because he wasn't a military strategist. He was an actor. And he didn't know the script. And he went off script. And they didn't like it. So the reality is, it's a nuclear war fighting machine. It's designed for fighting nuclear war. And if you say, oh, yes, but we don't actually intend to fight a nuclear war, well, you don't say that because that undermines the deterrent effect and you're not allowed to say that. So you can't take, there's no moral out by going, oh, yeah, but we're never actually going to fight a nuclear war. I'm like, that's not a moral out. That undermines the whole basis of spending, you know, trillions of dollars on nuclear weapons. So you have to make the claim, you have to commit to the moral position that you are going to fight a nuclear war. So Reagan Gorbachev wasn't true then, not true now. Benoit's program is the exception that proves my rule about funding. So actually, Benoit will very proudly and rightly so tell you that he takes no money from anyone that has a set position or normative perspective on these issues at all. That's amazing. He says it's the only such program in France. I'm not aware of any anywhere in the world. There may be, maybe there are, and I don't know, but like, I think it's fair to say that the vast amount of money that's used to do research in this field comes from either nuclear weapons possessing states or institutions that generally support the maintenance of nuclear weapons. But anyway, I'd argue that nuclear knowledge is the exception that proves the rule. Is the Hotel California effect international? More examples outside the US. It's a really good point. As usual, I pick on the US because the US is most transparent, so they get it in the neck. So sorry about that. I think it's international, but as I said, basically, these are ideas that have kicked around in my research, but I've never taken the time and effort to actually write them up because, to be honest, like, I'm not going to make a lot of friends with this presentation, right? So it's not something that I have been incentivized to do, right? Because like, making this presentation is not going to get me funding from the FCDO. It's just not, right? So I need to look into that question more. I can give you a ton of questions from US allies. Sorry, I tell them examples from US allies, but I haven't looked in detail at other contexts. But you know, I do know that in the Russian context, like saying the words nuclear disarmament is not great for your career. I've talked to Russian officials, I've talked to Russian academics and think tankers, and they're like, yeah, no, you don't say those words in Russia, right? Because it's not good for your career. If the Hotel California is true, what do we do about it? So my answer is let a thousand flowers bloom. Not that I think Mao is a great person to be quoting, but whatevs. First of all, the only way out of the hotel is just to get up and walk out. The only way out is to say, I do not believe that nuclear weapons are a net security benefit. And if you're willing to say that, then a lot of the other problems drop away. The political problems and the money problems don't drop away, but like the psychological problems drop away, and then you're empowered to actually speak your truth. There's so much more I could go into there, but you know, for time I won't. On Benoit's fantastic point about fear not being a trigger to engagement in nuclear policy, but sadness, and coming to your question, Nicola, I would like to see a full video reel, interactive, real-time experience of a nuclear blast in an urban environment. And I would like to see policymakers who claim that they are willing to support a nuclear war, for example, in NATO and other US allies and nuclear weapon states around the world, I would like to see those policymakers required to go through the experience of a video reel virtual reality nuclear blast in an urban center before they make that claim. And I would also like to see people that go through war games and choose to use nuclear weapons as a part of war gaming required to do the same thing, because I think it would make it much more real for them what they're actually claiming to be willing to do. And then they might rethink that willingness when it actually comes time to take the job that would require them to make that decision, for example, or say the words in public that they are required to say in public. What do we do about it? My big picture is actually, so I've just written a whole article on a global nuclear verification system built on a carbon negative blockchain and incentivized through the issuance of verification coin cryptocurrency based on elite social and automated verification to include open source verification. And I think the way that you do it is to quote Buckminster Fuller, You never change things by fighting the existing reality. To change something, build a new model that makes the old model obsolete. So if the current reason that we can't disarm is because all of the incentives are to maintain the status quo, then we need to build a global societal system in which peace is a profitable business. You need to be able to make money and build political careers and build social movements and build cooperative societies in which you can put food on your family's table by verifying the absence of nuclear threats. And if we can build a system where you can put food on your family's table by actively contributing to the verification of the absence of nuclear threats, then I think we've created a world in which it's possible to imagine walking away from Hotel California. Time on a yes. I'm going to leave it there because I've spoken a lot as well. But yeah, thanks very much.
Thanks so much, Nicola, for your really excellent questions. So firstly, on this point about the moral burden, I should clarify what I mean by that is essentially political pressure for disarmament. So I think for countries that face obstacles in or have a hard time justifying retaining nuclear weapons and embarking on nuclear modernization programs, it's a strong rhetorical asset to be able to say, we are not doing this just for ourselves, but we are doing this because our allies are asking for it, essentially. So that trope or that rhetoric was very prevalent when the UK Parliament authorized Trident renewal in 2015 under Theresa May. So it's definitely not limited to the United States. And I think it's also increasingly the case with France, where I think French elites, and Benoit and I have written a paper about this called European Nuclear Weapons? I think the French elites have realized increasingly that they've missed a trick by being on the outside of the NATO nuclear planning group, because they don't have the same access to those kinds of arguments that the Brits and the Americans have. And that also partly explains this French push for Europeanization of the French nuclear arsenal. So this goes back to the 50s. With France proposing some kind of European concerted deterrent arrangement, as they call it. And we see that as answering to some of those same sort of pressures and impulse to, as I've called it, lessen the moral burden. I could equally call it trying to deflect or pulverize political pressure. That's essentially what I'm getting at as being one of the benefits of a nuclear umbrella from the perspective of the security patron. Could it happen with other states as well, Russia and China? I don't know enough about the internal politics there, but my general sense would just be that they have, due to their domestic political systems, less of a need to justify their modernization programs in that way, because they're authoritarian states. It's easier for them to just make decisions. And there's probably less pressure from civil society groups. Of course, I think this argument that there is no pressure and that there's no domestic politics in nuclear weapon states is absolutely wrong. I think they also, authoritarian states also can be influenced through norms. But I think probably on this point, there is my sense would be that there is a slight difference there. Then just very quickly about them. About third parties, and that I'm in this paper not really saying anything about whether or not deterrence worked, in quotation marks. I mean, that's just because the sort of precise research question that I'm trying to get at is why, if Norway didn't find the extended deterrent credible, did it not seek reassurance, essentially? So, of course, the deterrent effect is relevant to that question insofar as Norwegian elites had ideas about the deterrent effect vis-a-vis the Russians. And what I'm arguing is that very influential high-level Norwegian policymakers from the 90s till today don't really think nuclear weapons are particularly relevant in defending a Russian incursion in, you know, the Barents Sea against Norwegian oil installations or anything like that. And then the final question about time, I think I'll just take that as a comment rather than I don't think I'll be able to properly answer that. I agree. The longer something goes on, the more difficult it is to upend it, I think. So yeah, I agree with that.
Thank you. Benoit, just before you answer, I'm going to add 5 minutes onto this panel because if that's okay with you all, just because we have three hands up in the air after your comments, Benoit, and I did talk a lot at the beginning. So Benoit, please.
Okay, so then I'll be brief, but I want to express gratitude. I mean, your engagement with the paper is fabulous. So I'll take it in two parts. One is how does that operate in Lyndon's world in which material constraints are defining, and the other one is an implementation problem of a cultural proposition. So I don't think it's incompatible at all with Lyndon's proposition, because some policymakers and some advocates act in a world that has been constituted by those material interests, but they don't actively feel that, you know, they're lobbyists for this. No, they feel that they are totally neutral. And so if you go to them and you say, you've been misinformed, you know, there is an aspect of things that you haven't been told about, which is a form of nuclear vulnerability. Let me tell you what this is. The hope is that they would be willing to take in new information. And the hope is essentially policymaking elites. If you tell them, like, look, your advisors have given you an incomplete picture, here is a more complete one, it's free and we're available to you, at least some of them will not shut the door and will exercise independent judgment. As to their impact, I mean, I think there is clear evidence, you know, Reagan was shaken by the day after. I mean, arguably also because the character was his old friend, Jason Robards, who ends up kind of dying in a reversed version of the cowboy that they both were once were. And so Reagan came down and told the people who were advocating limited nuclear war that they were crazy after watching the day after. So we have kind of some evidence of impact. More fundamentally, I think, in terms of impact, we have an impact on the broader public. And here I'm relying on a great book by William Knobloch called Nuclear Freeze in a Cold War, in which he shows that the birth of the freeze movement, which I would treat as a force that actually changed US nuclear policy, both in terms of leading to the INF and also leading to kind of arms reduction in general. The birth of the freeze movement is a combination of the concept of nuclear winter, Carl Sagan, Jonathan Schell's The Fate of the Earth, that we now have evidence that the Reagan administration tried to contain but failed, and the day after. So you put those three in the mix at the same time, and you get the freeze movement. To me, that sounds, that counts as not insignificant. And so that's how I would make this claim compatible with Lyndon's world in saying those interests in the 80s, I don't think they were more powerful than they are now. I mean, they were very powerful then, they are very powerful now. Were they more or less? I don't really know. In terms of implementation now, which is you're absolutely right. Like, none of us wants to go through the cultural experience of like total dread. But yeah, I think there are two there are two dimensions to this. One is there is still the appeal of horror films. So there are some negative emotions that somehow are appealing that we could connect with or mobilize. And the other thing in general, I mean, yeah, two more points. One is the virtual reality experience and what Sharon Weiner and Moritz Kut are doing now promises to be very helpful for leaders in helping them realize what this is. But the problem is we can no longer do the day after in terms of we can't have 100 million households watching the same TV program. The problem we're facing is fragmentation. In the fact that our audiences are so much more separate from each other. I guess the final point I would make is that there is a flip side of this argument, which is the final section that I didn't mention. That would also responsabilize the people who are producing cultural content, because you would show to them that since 1990, they've essentially not just normalized nuclear weapons, but they've turned them into weapons that can only cause minimal harm, that are sometimes weapons of salvation, even sometimes by reversing myths that were supposed to show you the harm they could cause. I mean, I'm thinking mostly about the Godzilla narrative, where originally Godzilla is the epitome of the outcome of nuclearity. And in the 2010s, Godzilla, you shoot it with nuclear explosives. So those are kind of three quick responses, but thank you again.
Wonderful, thank you all. I've got three hands. I saw Paul first, then I saw, is it Janine? Sorry if I pronounced that name wrong, and then Sol. So if you, I know that I wasn't concise and I wasn't quick, but if you could be concise and quick, it's super appreciated, thank you.
I'll try and be concise. Three very good presentations. On the Norwegian case, I mean, the problem with you knowing people in Norway who don't think this is credible is that I know people who think that it was or is. We could produce them. It's hard to know who's right. There's also the question of solidarity, NATO solidarity, which is a thing that some people believed in. If we had somebody from the Baltic states or Poland here, they might not think that Norway deciding to go its own skeptical nuclear way is good for NATO or Europe. There's also the question of what nuclear weapons do, countervailing Russian nuclear blackmail if they threaten to escalate if NATO gets lucky in conventional war. That's a function of that nuclear weapons have, without maybe having to explode at all, preventing easy Russian escalation dominance. And finally, I think the phrase that ought to come up is the one that Brad Roberts uses, that America is reluctant to be NATO's convenient nuclear executioner, that it wants to see, rather than the spiritually advanced Europeans distancing themselves from thermonuclear war, it wants to see some involvement, because American leaders are not necessarily confident that the American public will do it alone if others who are supposed to be being defended say no. So I mean, there's a whole set of points there. For Lyndon, I like your Hotel California thing, but maybe it's the wrong place. What about the Hotel Sao Paulo? Because California has the idea if you make the jailbreak, there's space out there where everybody can live happily together. But in a Brazilian jail, there are no warders who are going to stop brutal behavior. There's nowhere to get out. And once you leave your cell, your nuclear cell, you're exposed to the exploitative violence of others, including very, very violent others. So, your analogy is interesting, but you maybe want to consider how it varies with the conditions of the penitentiary, and the Hotel California is not necessarily the right one. And I also want to say and I shall say this tomorrow, that it seems to me we are generally talking about why we disagree. How is it possible that highly intelligent people with a great deal of information disagree? And I think there are subcultural and psychological reasons which we're reluctant and often don't have time enough to talk about, and which are not, you know, which may be as strong in some cases as loads of money. So Ambassador Kim Ent was mentioned. There's someone who's absolutely made his career. There are plenty of others who have made their career within the disarmament archipelago, espousing an abolitionist position. There are others. There are scholars. And I suspect that in the academy, it's not necessarily a bad thing to be a nuclear skeptic. There are careers to be made. I think we can see them. And that has an interesting divergence in the sort of people who talk about this are not thinking in the same ways with the same incentives as those who make the decisions. So some of the things they have to say are just not going to fit about what is happening. I'll talk further tomorrow. And finally, Benoit, I loved your idea. Let's use fiction. I loved your idea of a book looking at, there is in fact a book looking at nuclear war films, which I'll send you in case you haven't seen it. But we ought to be thinking of the fictions of different paths to war. There's a whole genre which points out how nuclear war can begin. And often that's through measures you wouldn't want to take, sort of determination, deterrence, etc. And when that fails, then you drift into war. There's a book by Lindley French on future war in Europe, which came out this year, which is exactly that. And there have been Sir John Hackett's thing. So there's a whole genre, and it seems to me you would need to explore the plausibility of different scenarios, arguing different things, because books are written to lead the reader, and films are made to make the audience believe different things about the nuclear risks and where it comes from. And HMS Vigil, by the way, is absolutely terrible. And there's an example of a filmic creation, which is so obviously fixed towards a certain conclusion that it's very difficult for those who are not already persuaded to watch it without switching off. But here we're into the question of what balance would be. We don't escape that question of what we think is a fair representation of nuclear risk by saying, let's look at fiction. We're going to disagree about what we think of the various fictions according to our subcultural and personality presuppositions that we bring to the whole subject, if that's not too nihilist.
Okay, thanks, Paul. Is it Jolene?
Hey, Celine.
Thank you.
So for London, actually, all three presentations were excellent. Thank you so much. But for London, first question is just thinking how you get out of the Hotel California. I think the moral movements of the day is quite powerful. I mean, slave traders were in this hotel too. Like in South Africa, the apartheid machinery, people who worked in that were in the Hotel California too, and they get out of it. And I think you're absolutely right. The first step is just to say, you know, the emperor doesn't have any clothes on. The second point is also, it's similar to what Paul said, that careers are being made on the anti-nuclear side of things or arms control side of things. In fact, I want to pose the question to you whether nuclear weapons are not necessary. Are some of us in this arms control ICANN business not occupying the budget rooms in the Hotel California, maybe not the top suites? So, you know, in South Africa, we gave up nuclear weapons, or the country gave up nuclear weapons. I can tell you it's very hard for somebody like me interested in it to get funding and to really get anything together, a critical mass to pursue a career in this field. And then just for Benoit, so I know you asked us to say certain things about your paper, and I don't think you want us to add new things, but I do want to say, I think for children, popular culture starts with cartoons. And I remember by chance seeing this little cartoon made from Dr. Seuss's The Butter Battle. And my son of at that point 3 was watching it with me, and you know, that's where it started. So you may want to look at that as a genre as well. I know my son today is of six. He's a vegetarian because of films. The Happy Feet was especially one that swayed him of not eating meat anymore. And then just something on the emotion that you feel. I think empathy is especially an emotion that's triggered by popular culture. I remember showing this, it was a documentary on nuclear weapons and the day after Hiroshima, that kind of thing. And one of the Ibakusha was talking about, she was narrating how she saw a woman trying to breastfeed after the bomb had exploded, and this baby was crying. And, you know, I showed it several years in a row. And it was only when I was breastfeeding myself and I saw this that I got so emotional in class. I was literally in tears. And it was, so for me, that's kind of the empathy thing that I wanted to bring to the emotion that can be triggered. And yeah, so just those 2 points.
Thanks, Jenny. And the last is for Sol. Please be quick, as quick as you can be.
Sure. Yeah, I'll try to be. So thanks to all three presenters. My question is directed to the second presenter on US-Norwegian alliance. Partially, and I got two comments/questions, and it's partially because I'm working on a similar topic as well. First is, I wonder how much the US-Norwegian alliance case can travel across, partially because we all know that the United States implemented different strategies in Asia and Europe for one. And there's a forthcoming piece in security studies titled Strategies of Extended Deterrence. I just checked, it's not available online. And he actually wrote like 120 page appendix. So going through all different types of extended deterrence cases. So I thought that might be very helpful as well. I think this talks to like the different strategies or different types of extended deterrence we can actually see. And it's not the same, it's not a one size fit all within this concept. And the second, I think, related part would be how much of the alliance politics context do you actually use? Because I think, you know, Glenn Schneider's work can actually come in really, really handy. And that's how my co-author and I are actually approaching this, because if there are different strategies of extended deterrence, and an actual extended deterrence scenario would have ebb and flows, and there's variations within them that might actually matter to the endurance part of your research in terms of theorizing as well as contextualizing as well. Those are my 2 points. Hope that was short enough.
Yeah, that was very good. Thank you. Now, obviously, you don't have time as panelists to answer all those questions. So, Lyndon, Shov, and Benoit, I'll give you the opportunity to reply to any of that. Please don't try to reply to all of it. But I also obviously encourage you to engage with the speakers and those that have posed the questions to have a conversation that's, you know, fuller conversation afterwards. So, Lyndon, any thoughts or comments briefly?
Grant, thank you. Lots of thoughts, lots of comments. I'll limit them to a couple. Paul, if you can show me a song called Hotel Sao Paulo that is one of the most famous, universally known songs on the planet, I will happily change the title of my piece. But until such time, I'm going with Hotel California. And a general comment that it kind of speaks to a lot of the different stuff that's come out. I want to be really clear and say I'm not taking a material approach to the problem of nuclear disarmament. I wrote a whole PhD, you know, on identity and its relationship to policy, right? So I'm all about that security is socially constructed, identities and norms are socially constructed, et cetera. In that regard, it is let a thousand flowers bloom. The whole movement to redefine the concept of security, to redefine the concept, you know, towards humanitarian ideas, R2P, planetary security more recently in the Anthropocene age, right? There's a whole movement now around, you know, planet politics and planetary security. all of these things are really important in changing the nature of the debate around the utility or otherwise of nuclear weapons. And all of those will continue to contribute to debates around whether people see nuclear weapons to be a, quote, net security benefit. Because we change the definition of security, it changes what you perceive to be useful. As for people making their career in disarmament, look, I don't have figures to give you, but I tell you what, I spent 17 years writing a lot of papers with the words nuclear disarmament in the title, and it has not been a profitable business. So that's just my personal experience. But I would wager, if I were a betting man, I'd wager good money that the number of people making a useful career and having social status and having access to the most powerful policymakers in the world who made their career on nuclear disarmament is minuscule and can probably be counted on the fingers of one hand, compared to over 8 decades, the number of people who made, you know, and I'm talking, you know, wildly off the top of my head, I would estimate tens of thousands of people have made a career selling the idea that nuclear weapons are good for security, and in the process got social status, recognition, and access to the most powerful policymakers in the world. So I think there's just no comparison in my personal perspective. And I think that comes back to talking not just about economics and material factors, but like power and who has power and who allows access to power, et cetera. And the whole system we live in allows you that access to power if you support nuclear weapons. And it does not allow you that access to power if you don't support nuclear weapons, as a generalization, obviously.
Thanks, Lyndon. Sure.
Thanks very much. I'll try to be really brief. Paul, thanks very much for your comments. Solidarity is a very good point and is another reason to go along with extended nuclear deterrence in the absence of credibility. So I should definitely add that to the presentation and to the paper more explicitly than I do now. And then on the second point that you've talked to Norwegians who say they think it's credible, I mean, that's sort of perfectly aligned with my argument. What I'm attacking is this 95% confidence threshold. So anything below 95% is, I would argue, fits my theory. Also, I would say that if my theory is correct, then and I don't know what conversations with Norwegian policymakers or elites you were referring to, but I would say that if my theory is correct, then certainly active Norwegian policy elites, non-retired ones, would have, when speaking to you, someone they probably would see as a, broadly speaking, representative of the defense establishment of a nuclear armed state and a senior member of the alliance, they would, as representatives of a junior member of the alliance, probably perceive a incentive or an impetus to go along with what they think you want to hear. That's perhaps a cheeky comment. Sol, thanks very much for your suggestions. I think I'm gonna have to look more into what you mentioned, the paper on extended deterrence strategies, also Snyder, that is a part of my paper. Then on, just super quickly, on how well the Norwegian case travels, I think empirically, maybe not very well, but I would say theoretically it does, in the sense that if you take the theory is the mainstream view at face value, Norway should be a state that would be very interested in sort of nuclear defense and a strong extended deterrence guarantee. And the puzzle that I'm trying to say something about is why, given that so many, maybe not all, but so many Norwegian defense elites didn't think it was credible, they just accepted that it wasn't credible and just and didn't ask for reassurance measures. So yeah, thanks very much for all the comments. Super helpful. Thanks.
Jolene, comment taken on looking at the children. Absolutely, it's like it's going to be a lot of work because this is a you know, the area I know nothing about. But you know, totally valid comment. Paul, we need to have a conversation about this because about this, actually the scope of what I'm looking at is essentially the scope as it is now is to say it's a fact that everyone accepts that nuclear war is possible, desired or not. And we have, as you said, psychological reasons, rationalist reasons, ideological reasons to act as if that's not the case. And that's kind of documented by a lot of people before me. I'm thinking about, you know, Hugh Gustafson on the People in the Lab, the psychologist, Danny Kahneman on all the forms of illusions of control. And so my very modest point in the end is just one step forward would be to get policymakers and citizens aware of this possibility that they are essentially hardwired to negate. And the reason why I think that's important is that if they go to their expert advisors who are well-versed in the art of nuclear deterrence discourse, of course they have to make the performative claim that the whole operation works. So essentially they will not get the narrative that there are remaining vulnerabilities. So the goal I'm having is just fix that. And the question I have for you is, when you said I should look at different scenarios, do you think that there are other scenarios about how war starts that are as hard to believe as the ones I've just outlined? Because my assumption, and maybe I'm wrong on that one, my assumption is that it's easier to accept that it's possible for conventional wars to start, and we can think of various ways in which they could start. The reason why I focused on this, because I thought that reality was much harder to accept. But, you know, be happy to hear what you think about that.
Yeah, we should speak, but maybe not now, although sure. I'd be happy.
Wonderful. Yes, thank you very much, both of you. We are wildly over time, but it's okay. We've gone into the break. And what I suggest is that we still take 10 minutes, because I don't know about you, but I need 10 minutes. And that's only because I need 10 minutes, because it was an incredibly stimulating panel. So thank you to all the panelists. We will come back in 10 minutes or so. We will not be recording the next session. So take notes if you want to remember what everybody said. I'm